Over 160,000 students are signed up to take the AP Chemistry exam this May. It will be a 3-hour and 15-minute marathon where only the strong will emerge with that coveted passing score. But if you know the secrets I'm about to share with you, you can raise your score and get every single point you're entitled to on the exam. Hi there. My name is Jeremy Krug, and I've been teaching AP Chemistry for the past 24 years, and I've helped hundreds of students pass the AP exam, and I'm going to share my secrets with you. But before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to my channel so you'll have full access to my 101 video AP Chemistry course playlist with complete daily lessons, along with my quick 10-minute review videos over every unit, as well as study tips, question walkthroughs, and more. And if you find this video helpful, if you'd be so kind as to click that like button. This is a fairly small channel, but your likes and shares help get my videos out to other great AP Chem students like yourself. Now, let's get started. My first secret tip: on the free response section, there is no penalty for carry-through errors. So let's say you have a four-part question and you miss the answer to part A. If you use that wrong answer for part A to solve part B, well, as long as everything else is correct, you'll still get full credit for part B. You can use this to your advantage. If you don't have much of an idea on an early part of a question, don't give up. You can still do your best, and even if you miss part A completely, you can still get full credit on the rest of the question. You'd be surprised how many students look at part A of a multi-part question, don't know how to do that part, and just leave the entire question blank. Don't ever do that. If you've been studying and reviewing, you should know how to do at least part of the question. So remember, no penalty for carry-through errors. Now for my second secret tip. You have to respect significant figures on the exam. Lots of students forget about significant figures on the AP Chemistry exam, and it ends up costing them points. Generally speaking, the readers expect you to use a reasonable number of significant figures in an answer. That means however many figures you're supposed to use, they'll give you a tolerance of one in either direction. So if an answer should have three significant figures, you won't be penalized as long as you use two, three, or four significant figures in an answer. Now, in all my years teaching this course, I've never seen a problem on the exam that has fewer than two or more than four significant figures. In fact, the vast majority of the time, the problems will have two or three sig figs. Always try to use the correct number of significant figures when working problems, but if you're not exactly sure how many to use, you'll never go wrong with three. You'll always be within the tolerance for sig figs. Speaking of significant figures, there's usually a question somewhere on the exam. It might be multiple choice, it might be free response, but you'll be expected to make a reading of some kind of volumetric instrument, most likely a graduated cylinder or burette. On that specific question, you have to be spot on for the number of significant figures to earn that point. Remember to read between the lines, give all the digits you're sure of, and estimate that next place you're unsure of. And if the bottom of the meniscus is somewhere between the lines, it's probably a 5. If the bottom of the meniscus is really close to the line, it's probably a 0. So respect significant figures in those answers. Now, for secret tip number 3. Make sure you include appropriate units on your answers. On the free response section, you're often solving problems, calculating moles, mass, concentration, something like this. You have to put correct units, otherwise you won't get the point, even if your answer is otherwise correct. So pay close attention to those units, and make sure you use the correct unit too. If the question asks for a value in joules per mole, give it in joules per mole. If it asks for kilojoules, give it in kilojoules. Make sure that unless it's an equilibrium constant or a pH, if you give a number as an answer, you have an appropriate unit next to it. Secret tip number 4 is always show your work for every problem you do. Throughout the year, a lot of students get in the habit of doing work in their head and on a calculator, and they don't show any work. Some of your teachers may have let you slide by in class doing this, but that's not going to fly on the AP exam. You have to show your work. Let me give you an example of this. Let's say you have this question where you have a 150 milliliter sample of a 0.036 molar solution of nitric acid. Part A asks you to calculate the pH of this solution. If you just type negative log 0.036 into your calculator and write down 1.44, and that's all you write, do not expect to get the point. You need to show the reader your process. You have to write down negative log of 0.036 and that it equals 1.44. Remember, science is more about the method and the process than it is about just getting a right answer. It's the same thing here in Part B. The question asks you to calculate the number of moles of HNO3 present in the container. If all you do is type in 0.150 times 0.036 and write down the answer, 5.4 times 10 to the negative 3, and you don't show your work, you probably won't get the point. You have to show the reader your process. So you should write down 0.150 liters times 0.036 moles per liter equals 5.4 times 10 to the negative 3 moles, and then you get full credit. Always show your work. My secret tip number 5 is study units 3 and 8 very well. The AP Chemistry curriculum has 9 units, and you might think that each unit is represented equally on the exam, but that's absolutely not the case. On the 2024 exam, right around 20% of the entire exam is going to come solely from Unit 3, which is the Intermolecular Forces unit. So if you're short on time, study Unit 3. And Unit 8 is right behind. On the 2024 exam, College Board will assign right around 14% of the exam to Unit 8, which is acids and bases. That means that just those two units, intermolecular forces and acid-base chemistry, will account for right at 1/3 of your AP score. And if you need somewhere to start reviewing, check out my Unit 3 and Unit 8 videos, either the quick 10-minute review videos, or if you prefer, the longer full course daily videos for those units. As for the other 7 units, those are going to be represented fairly equally on the exam. Somewhere around 9% of your exam will come from each of those other units. So your best bet, of course, is to know all 9 units, but spend extra time studying units 3 and 8. Secret tip number 6 is when the question asks you to explain, make sure you give a full explanation of your answer. Sometimes you'll have a question that asks you to justify your answer with a calculation. For those questions, showing your work is good enough. However, if you're asked to explain, that means you need to use complete sentences to make a claim and then give evidence as to why your claim is correct. And then you need to show the relevance of that evidence. Let me give you an example. This question says, predict which ionic compound has a higher melting point, KCl or K2S. Explain your answer. So this student just answers K2S. No explanation? So no point. But how about this answer? This student answers K2S will have a higher melting point because the magnitude of charge in K2S is greater than the magnitude of charge present in KCl. This is a better answer, but it still doesn't quite get the full gist of what's going on here. This answer has the claim, it even has the evidence, but it doesn't tell us why that evidence is relevant. To fully explain something, we have to say why the evidence is relevant. Why do we care about the magnitude of charge? In fact, the College Board says, and this is in their official document, explain why requires analysis of motivation or the reasons for the relationship, process, pattern, position, situation, or outcome. So let's look at this answer. K2S will have a higher melting point because the magnitude of charge in K2S is greater than the magnitude of charge present in KCl. Ionic compounds with a greater magnitude of charge should have stronger Coulombic attractions, which means that these compounds have a greater lattice energy, leading to a higher melting point. Do you see how that answer is a better answer? We have a claim, we have the evidence, and we have the relevance, which tells us why the evidence matters. So when you write a short essay, think of these three parts: claim, evidence, and relevance, or CER for short. It doesn't have to be multiple paragraphs long, but it does need to get the job done. Secret number 7 for the AP exam: make good use of your calculator throughout the exam. You are allowed to use a calculator on both the multiple choice and free response sections of the test. I recommend that you use the calculator that you're most familiar with, hopefully the one you've used every day in class. And just a reminder, you are not required to clear the memory of your calculator, so any programs that you may have saved in memory are okay to use during the exam. And that's all I'm going to say about that. Now, for my 8th and last secret for the AP Chemistry exam. Easy questions and difficult questions are worth the same amount on the exam, so make sure you get all the easy ones. Sometimes students don't realize that there are plenty of easy questions throughout the exam. Or maybe there are a couple of units you feel more confident about. Don't spend so much time working the harder questions that you run out of time to do the easier ones. If you're aiming for a 5, you can still afford to miss about 20% of the points on the exam. If you're aiming for a 3, you'll likely need to aim for somewhere around 50% of the points on the exam. A good strategy is to start the multiple choice test by going through the whole test, all 60 questions, and skim the questions to find the easy ones and work those first. Get those answered and bubbled. Then make a second pass through the test, working the ones you know how to do but are just harder and take a little more time. Answer and bubble those. Then finally, make a third pass of the questions that you really don't know how to do, but maybe you can use some of your chemical intuition to eliminate a choice or two and make a reasonable guess. Finally, any questions that you're completely clueless on, just take a blind guess and be done with it. The same thing goes for the free response questions. Answer the easy ones first and focus on the harder ones last. An easy point is worth the same as a harder point, so don't leave any easy points on the table. Now, some of you might be in need of a little extra review and practice before the big day in May. And if you are, then I've got the thing for you. Head over to ultimatereviewpacket.com and check out my AP Chemistry study packet. I've prepared 9 in-depth study guides with practice problems and solutions that cover every one of the 91 topics in the course. You'll find full-length review videos, a full practice exam with answers, and everything else you need to succeed on the exam. The Ultimate Review Packet is just $24.99, and if your teacher gets the packet for the whole class, it knocks the price down to just $14.99 per student. It's the greatest AP Chemistry review deal out there. Well, those are my 8 secrets for taking the AP Chemistry exam. I hope you use these to sail to success on your exam this year. If you found them helpful, please consider smashing that like button and sharing this video with your classmates and colleagues. I would really appreciate it. About 2 days after the exam, I'll be posting my free response walkthroughs, so keep an eye out for those. And don't forget to subscribe so you won't miss a thing. Best wishes to all of you on this year's exam, and thanks for watching.